those of you who have questions, I see they have already typed it in the chat box. And the first question is by whoever is raising your hands, you can please type in the Q&A. There's a Q&A link on your screens where you can type in your questions. So the first question is by Baby Vishwambaran. The question is, what is the criteria of choosing unnatural amino acid? And one of the criteria, so if you look at so when I look at my selectivity inducers, we already have some understanding of how these systems work. So we know from the literature that pi-box units would work with cations. With these triazoles, there is also some literature of them binding to anions. So at that point, we weren't sure. But based on some input from some of my friends, they had said having the pyridyl next to the triazole, the inorganic chemist suggested that this might like divalent ions, so which is why we thought that would be a good selectivity inducer. Pyrroles, when you have an amide group next to it, is known to bind anions, so which is why that's why we chose this as a selectivity inducer. So the criteria is A, it should have an affinity for the ion that we are interested in targeting. B, it should not be too disruptive in terms of it should not interact too much with the rest of the structure and change the structure of the molecule we are looking at. And in the macrocyclic system, it's the same thing. When you have a pyridyl group with the CONH groups, the NH amide groups can be can participate in anion selectivity. I hope that answers your query. So next question is by Kakoli Malakar. The question is, why was the acyclic precursor better than the cyclic? For us, it was better because it was cheaper to make, but jokes apart, what you see from the model which I showed you is, this is what I will tell you based on our understanding. So if you look at this model, I show you four or two peptides coming together. For the cyclic peptide, which is more disc-like, you would need eight of them to come together to span the lipid bilayer. There's a lot of research already done on this. So since we can accomplish the same using a smaller concentration of the peptide, so that's why probably it works better than the cyclic precursor in terms of activity. And here again, I think the selectivity comes mainly from the carbonyl groups probably interacting with the cations. So because they are not involved in the hydrogen bonding, those might also be more available in the acyclic precursor. Again, a question from Kakoli, why is the selectivity high for copper? Now, this is something which is known in the literature where people use these pi-box ligands for binding with copper. And there are series which you can look at for the binding affinity of ligands with cations, and this just follows that series. So it's highest for copper and it's slightly lower for calcium. And among the biologically relevant ions, these are the two ions which are of interest to us. So which is why we chose this particular motif in the first place. So why valinomycin only? Because it's known to be very selective for potassium. So I'm guessing this is for the assay. So since it, so if I go to the slide with the assay, so here what you see is what we want to do is we want to find an alternate pathway for this H plus going out. I don't think you can see my cursor here. We want to see if we can generate a different pathway for the H plus coming out. So valinomycin, what it does is, had M plus ions been coming in, valinomycin would allow for K plus to go out. So we do this assay where we have potassium only inside, we do not have potassium outside. So we have a concentration gradient to drive the potassium to go outside. So valinomycin would work if you have M plus coming in. But in this case, we don't see much of a difference in ion transport rate because of addition of villinomycin. So that's how we know that it doesn't allow for the H plus M2 plus antiport pathway. Will not these substances cause gene mutation? Gene mutation generally, I don't know, you would probably need something to intercalate to the DNA. I'm not a biologist. In general, we do, so the studies, again, I'm not a biologist, but what Shobhna has done with some of these peptides is she's looked at how they interact with the cells. So if we were to use it in vivo for therapeutic applications, there are assays we can use to ensure that these will not interact. I mean, these do not cause any harm to the good cells. We only want them to target the cancer cells in, if you're targeting, say, cancer. But again, as I said, I'm not a biologist, so I might not be able to give you a very good answer. But some of these compounds are not very toxic, so they might be okay. But the toxic ones, obviously, you do not want to put them in the body. So what is the general approach? So this is a question from VG Balaji. What is the general approach you take for tuning the number of units in the macro cycle? So this, I think, and were you able to limit the number of substitutions on the cycles such as cholesterol? So this question is for the macro cycle work. So here what we found is the major product that we get is among the macro cycles, or what he observed is this triamide. And one of the reasons for this could be that you have this pyridine lone pair, which could be hydrogen bonding with this NH. And I think that could be a reason for it to even allow for the cyclization. Because what we saw is if we do this reaction with an aromatic ring without the pyridine, just benzene, we do not get formation of this macrocycle at room temperature. So it's more facile when you have this pyridine. And I think once it has this sort of a bent structure, it would cyclize to form this triamide. So I think if we do this reaction at probably a higher temperature and a higher concentration, we might get a large number of oligomers and maybe other macrocycles as well. The trick to getting this is we do a nice mix of, so we keep the reaction rate slow enough so that we can get this thermodynamically favored macrocycle. At the same time, it's not that slow where you have no reactivity. So the key here is the reaction conditions, as I said, dilution and the reaction temperature. And we are able to limit the number of substitutions on the cholesterol. So if we, so to get the cholesterol, what we use is, so there are two approaches to this. One is I do cyclization having the cholesterol unit already attached to the pyridine. The other approach is where I add the R groups after I form the macrocycle, which is what we have been following. So we form the macrocycle. After that, we have actually not only added cholesterol, we had added alkyl units. And technically, it can be done, but it would be a little challenging. So depending on playing with equivalents, you can get either one or two or three cholesterol units attached to it. The next question is by Gopalan. Would you be able to control the stoichiometry of these transporters on a per vesicle basis? So in the studies that we have done, we are looking at bulk properties. So we do have, I mean, we control the concentration of channels per vesicle based on the loading that we have of compound with respect to lipid. So based on the mole percent of the compound that we take, on an average, we can predict how many transporters you have on a vesicle. So all you do is vary the concentration of the transporter that you add. So if you would add a lower concentration, you would have a lower number of peptides or macrocycles per vesicle. But again, the output that we get is of the bulk phenomenon, not at a single molecule level. There are assays where conductance measurements can be done at a single molecule level, and we are slowly going to get into those experiments as well to look at how this, but based on this, we can only tune it using concentration. Raju Vishwas has a question on the SymPort mechanism. So in general, the SymPort and antiport, SymPort is when you have a cation and anion both coming in the same direction. So I'm guessing your question might be for the calcium-based system where we observe the SymPort. Here, what we think is happening is once we have the calcium shown here going across the membrane, we think the hydroxide ions are just going as counter ions to the calcium. And we need to have either SymPort or antiport because over the time, you would want to maintain stability in the system. So these vesicles would want to maintain charge neutrality by having counter ions either. So if calcium is coming in, either anions would come in or cations would go out. If cations go out, it's called antiport because both the ions are going in opposite directions. If cation and anions are coming together, it's called SymPort. So in the case of calcium, we think these are just counter ions to the calcium. In the case of the pi box, we think it's mainly a proton copper antiport that is taking place. Satya Raghunathan has a question on which method is easy to synthesize peptides. To synthesize peptides, I guess, easiest in terms of time would be if you use a machine for it. Cheapest in terms of money would be if you do it mechanically, but it would be expensive with time. So in our other project, we are looking at methods to improve peptide synthesis. Samit Guha has a question, did you perform the patch clamp? So we have not done. For some of our earlier peptides, we had collaborated with Professor Amol Kanti Behra at IIT Madras, who did the planar bilayer conductance measurements. We have now gotten the equipment to do the bilayer membrane conductance studies. So we'll hopefully be able to do these studies. But we have mainly done our studies using vesicle-based techniques where we either use NMR for sodium transport or we use some sort of a dye as a probe or we use ion selective electrode. So we have a copper selective electrode, we have a calcium selective electrode, and we have a chloride selective electrode to look at these ions. Vishal Rai has a question, can ion channel formation and ion transportation differentiate the type of cells? Yes, so this actually, the next level for this would be for the peptides to distinguish based on the composition of the membrane. So here you would have to look at, so we have been focusing currently on the peptide ion interaction. The next level of challenge would be to also look at the peptide lipid interaction. And depending on the nature of the membrane, one can potentially tune peptides which would like to go to a specific type of cells based on the nature of the membrane. Or again, we can use some anchoring units and do that. But if we were to use the kind of philosophy that I spoke about in my presentation today, the next step for me would be to look at membrane peptide interactions. Question from Chandana, apart from ion channel application, have you tried any other? No, we have not tried. As I said, our expertise is in this area, but we would be happy to collaborate with anybody who wishes to try. As I said, Shobhna from our department has looked at the activity of the copper transporters on cancer cells and some bacterial cell lines, and there her group observes a copper dependent ion transport behavior and how they are able to, there is a copper concentration of copper seems to have an effect on the cell viability. So as the copper concentration increases, more of the cancer cells and bacterial cells get killed. Balaji VG, have you attempted cryo EM? We would love to do that, but we have not attempted. And with this small peptides, we might get a lot of information, but again, it's not our expertise. If anybody would wish us to try this, we'd be happy to share our peptides with them. So this again, I think, has been somebody has a question on the concentration per vesicle. I think I have addressed that. So we also do dose response studies. I didn't talk about that, where we essentially do that. We look at how the response is with respect to concentration of the peptide. Redmi, I don't know the name, but someone with a Redmi phone has a question. Is there any limitation of acyclic peptides? See, for anything, there would be pros and cons. For acyclic peptides, one thing is because of the conformational freedom. Again, it depends on the sequence. So if there isn't a lot of intramolecular hydrogen bonding, you might have a lot of interest. I mean, it might assemble to form more complex structures, which might be difficult to visualize. So characterization might be a challenge, but other than that, I don't think that would be a limitation at all. Marimuthu, what is the driving force for ion transport? Okay, so in one thing which I should have mentioned, it's a very good question, Marimuthu. In all these cases, what we are showing is what is called as passive transport. So here, the driving force for ion transport in general is the concentration difference between the external or internal vesicle solution, A. B is, why are we getting to go into the membrane in the first place? So there it depends again on what is your ion binding motif or the selectivity inducer that you have. So if you saw in the case of the macrocycles, we had a lot of amide bonds and electron deficient rings, and because of which they liked anions more. Whereas in my other scaffolds, which are the acyclic peptides, they like cations more because we were choosing here ligands which like to bind with cations. So depending on the selectivity inducer, you can select for which cation, whether it likes cation or anion. Now taking the answer to a slightly higher level, now between the cations, say I'm looking at going from sodium to cesium. There are two factors now again. One is cesium, although is bigger in size, the hydration sphere is not as much as in sodium. So if I'm looking at a situation where I'm just, where the peptide is say forming a hole-like structure, where you are mainly concerned at the size, right? So at that point, it might prefer to, for cesium to go through because it has a smaller hydration sphere. If I'm looking at specific interaction, say like hydrogen bonding, there when I go from chloride to bromide to iodide, it binds more to chloride because now you are looking at a different type of interaction between the peptide and the ion. So it depends again on how the peptide is interacting with the ion. In the cases where you have hydrogen bonding, you would see that it would select for chloride more than bromide. Otherwise, it's based, driven by the hydration energy. Manas, why acyclic peptides are more suitable compared? It's nothing about suitable, they're just simpler, right? So if I want to design a drug or something, say, I would want it to be as simple as possible. So with the acyclic peptide scaffolds that we are talking about, these are very simple to make as compared to the larger cyclic peptides. Also the macrocyclic scaffold that I spoke about, that's easy to make. So that's why if you can make something very easily, A, you can even tune it easily to get different types of selectivity. So that's the reason why I said acyclic peptides are suitable from a synthetic viewpoint. Chandramoli Subramaniam has a question. So can the concept of sensitivity be looked from the perspective of an external trigger? So sensitivity is low in the absence of trigger and high in the presence of trigger. Yes, so that's the last slide that I was talking about, where in the long term, actually we have a few students in the group working on it. Can we incorporate, this is something which has been done in the area of synthetic ion channels. So people have looked at getting either a voltage trigger. So this can be even done based on the dipole moment of the molecule that you're using, its inherent dipole moment. You can use light gating, where say if you have a gate, where it might bind inside the macrocycle in one particular, in the off state, and it might go outside the cycle in an on state. So this is what we, in the last slide, when I talk about stimuli responsive materials, that is what I was talking about. So Samit has a question. I understand that your ligand is binding with cations, but why is it transporting? I think towards the end, I spoke about this. One can think that the ligand will catch the ion and it would sit in the membrane. But again, here we are looking at a concentration gradient one. And the other thing is that the association constants would be very different inside the membrane and at the lipid-water interface. At the lipid-water interface, it would want to go in the aqueous region as opposed to coming into the bilayer. So the ligand helps in attracting the ion into the bilayer. Again, since you have a concentration gradient, it would deliver it to the other side, where again, it would give it back to the aqueous layer on the other side. So on continuation, can ligand be a 6-5-6? We have tried that actually. So we tried a 6-5-6 heterocyclic scaffold, if that's what you mean. So we put the triazole and we actually tried a 5-6-5. So yeah, we can also try 6-5-6 as long as it's easily synthetically accessible. Tanmoy Saha, is there any reason for C-terminal staying at the lipid water interface? So based on our initial model where when we hydrolyze the methyl ester at the C terminus, the ion transport activity increased for our octapeptides. I will go to that slide, Tanmay, so that it will make more sense to you. And later on, I think it's just based on our design. So here, when we see that the carboxylic acid seems to be more active, we think that might be because it is at the interface and it's also based on this model. And we have also done, I didn't speak about all this, we have also done in the case of pibox as well as triazole, varying the position of the selectivity inducer. And it seems that when you have it at the C terminus, that's when you have maximum activity. For example, even if I put a long alkyl chain at the C terminus, the activity seems to reduce. The second thing is, so here, since we have a directionality in a way, we have a long alkyl chain at the end terminus, I think that might guide how it goes into the lipid bilayer, which is why the selectivity would be more tuned at the C terminus. My window moved, yeah. How about the effect of pH? This is a question from Mohan Tarun. This is something what we are looking at currently. We want to look at how pH would affect. In the case of pyridine, I think there would definitely be an effect of pH. So anytime you have a group which has in your selectivity inducer, which is responsive to pH, you would see an effect of pH. So we are looking at that. Shayanta Roy, a man, is it only applicable for small peptides? So small peptides is what I'm talking about mainly because, as I said earlier, we just want it to be easily accessible. So that's why we are focusing on small, because if you want it to be commercially viable, why have large complicated structures if smaller structures can do the same job? Pooja, can a session be held for biological relations? I'm not an expert on that, but I'm sure there are many other speakers who can talk about more about the biology aspect of this. Ranjan Kumar Mohapatra, is it possible to place a metal ion in the macrocycle? As N atoms are there, it may be possible, but how the properties? So we were actually, initially we thought that it would really like metal ions. That's why in the slide also I say, will it transport cations as well as anions? We do not observe it in our assays at all. Now, I don't have a good answer for this. One could be that it binds very strongly, but no, that also won't be possible because we did some studies where we did NMR binding assays with sodium and potassium for the macrocycle without the alkyl chain. It does show a small shift, if I remember correctly, but we do not observe this at all with the alkylated macrocycles when we do the studies. So we don't know. It does not seem to like cations at this point, or it might be binding too strongly. Gopalan, what would be the distribution? I'm guessing you might be asking about the vesicle to peptide ratio. So if I'm looking at, I think if I remember correctly, 0.07, it's there in our paper, you can look at it. 0.07 micromolar would come to be around 0.1 mole percent, I think. If Parichita is there, she can type it in the chat box, the exact concentration. Shalini, hi Shalini, can synthesis of ester form by the help of HBTU between so you have a synthesis question? Yes, we were able to synthesize this, and I don't think Parichita had any DMAP in there. Lucky Oja, how you make buffer to make what concentration? So Lucky, when we do these assays, what we do is the initially when we start the experiment, we do not have the gradient in one type of experiments. So we induce a gradient by adding externally a small amount of a salt solution or a base. So it's either called in the literature, people call it as a base pulse. So this induces the concentration gradient. Otherwise, we do not have a concentration gradient across the membrane. Would you see gating in the absence? So without a membrane or a vesicle, if I'm able to get this porous thing into another polymer which can act as a scaffold for these peptides, one can still be able to accomplish gating, because essentially gating means you're opening and closing the cycle. So if there is some place where the cycle can actually sit as a gate, it's just like our, when you think of a playground, right? If there is no fence, then there is no point of a gate. So if I can find a good fence where this macrocycle can sit, it can still work as a gate. So this can be a polymer, need not be a lipid vesicle, but if this macrocycle can sit into some sort of a framework like this, then we can do it. So Binduja is asking about the computation methodology. So what we use is a typical package kind of computation. It's basically molecular mechanics level, nothing very fancy. And we use the Spartan program. Again, all the details are in the paper, the last OL, as well as the JAX paper earlier. So you can, ChemCom paper, I think. So you can look at the computation methodology. It's not very sophisticated. So there is a question on how these proteins achieve, in this case, peptides. As I said, the selectivity here is mainly achieved using the selectivity filter. And again, the selectivity is known in the literature. So it's basic fundamental principles of organic chemistry here. Okay, one would be just simple electrostatic interactions. For example, if you're doing hydrogen bonding, NH versus, as I said, as you go down the group, the interaction would decrease. And if I have NH, it would like anions. Now, if I have pyridyl groups which can bind, or ligands which can bind to cations, it would like cations because of the lone pairs. And again, there is lots of literature here which explains how it selects for a particular series of cations and anions. And by this scaffold, what we want to bring in is this rational concept where I just take what is known in the literature for organic and inorganic chemistry and just plug it into these peptide scaffolds to induce the selectivity. So I needn't invent the selectivity aspect of it. I can use the scaffold just to plug in, use these as plug-in filters, like you have plug and play in your computer. So just you plug it in there and you get the selectivity.